request our DDG sir and Professor Jyoti Satyapalan to please come onto the dais. As the introduction of the panelists will be played, I request the respective panel member to please come onto the dais.
Let us introduce our panel members. Ms. Seema Kumar is a Communication for Development Specialist, known as the C4D Specialist in UNICEF, in the Hyderabad field office for Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka and Telangana. She comes with a 28 years of communication experience. Currently, she caters to three large Indian states of Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, and Karnataka. In this role, she has led policy initiatives such as institutionalization of C4D within government systems and established a multi-sectoral technical resource unit. Ms. Shruti Patil is Indian Information Services Officer of the 2000 batch. She has served in various capacities in the Press Information Bureau, New Delhi, and the Press Information Bureau in Hyderabad. Her primary responsibility is to facilitate communication between government and media. She has been placed in media units of information and broadcast like Doordarshan, Directorate of Advertising and Visual Publicity, Press Information Bureau, and Directorate of Field Publicity and Publications Division. Now upgraded as the Regional Outreach Bureau, she is involved in the grassroots level communication on behalf of the Government of India. Shri Rizwan Ahmed is Director, Instructional Media Center, Maulana Azad National Urdu University in Hyderabad. He is a media professional, administrator and educationist with over 20 years of experience in media production, film programming, academics, training, e-learning, etc. He is a full member of the prestigious International Council for Film, Television and Audiovisual Communication. He has been the former Deputy Director to the Government of India and worked in the Directorate of Film, Ministry of Information and Broadcasting.
I request DDG sir to please present the bouquet to Mr. Rizwan Ahmed. Now I request Professor Jyoti Satyapalan to present the bouquet to Ms. Seema Kumar. I request DDG sir to please present the bouquet to Ms. Shruti Patil.
We all know that India has been struggling, and of course in the pandemic things have become worse. The underprivileged and poor blame the government for not helping them. But even though the government has schemes for these poor people, how are we supposed to get it to them? Not to mention the overlapping of schemes has always been an issue. Let's just hear this interview.
We work in the fields, but no one's hiring us anymore. My husband sold vegetables. What are we supposed to live on? What are we supposed to eat? The schools are closed. We can't send our children to class anymore. Taking care of all these people here is too big a task for their initiative. Their mother wonders why the government doesn't help.
This is where media should come in.
What are the constraints in effective dissemination of messages? Are political affiliations of media houses diluting the effect? Can media play a wider role? If mainstream media fails to deliver effectively, can social media be an alternative? If yes, how can we achieve a poverty-free society?
So, let's come together and discuss about this. We can make a change.
I request Professor Jyoti Satyapalan to please take over.
Respected DDG, Shashi Bhushan sir, Sri Rizwan Ahmed, Director, Instrumental Media Center, Maulana Azad University, Urdu University, Ms. Seema Kumar, C4D Communication Specialist, UNICEF, Ms. Sudhi Patil, Director, Press Information Bureau and Regional Outreach Bureau. It's in Hyderabad. Today, I think we have 20 minutes for this. That's what I understood. Each one of us will get 5 minutes to reflect on this particular topic. I'll take 3 minutes just to put the issue here. That's what I'm thinking. The topic here is poverty alleviation in rural India, role of media challenges and possibilities. So when I got this topic, immediately I strike the word rural. It's very important. I think after independence, when we started our planning, it was more a growth-oriented approach we have taken. You know, the productivity of agriculture was very low. Many people were working in agriculture, how to transfer these people to other sectors and put them in more productive way so the growth will trickle down everywhere, everyone will be well off. That was the approach in the beginning. Then if you see the conceptualization over a period of time, you can see we moved towards more equity-oriented, more inclusive-oriented kind of approach later period. Now we talk about inclusive growth, you know. We talk about sustainable growth. So we don't want to create the cake and share it to everybody. Everyone must be part of baking the cake. That is the whole idea. When this canvas, I think it's improved a lot. The idea is improved, the implementation style is also improved. And you can see that MNREGA is appeared here as a bottoms-up approach. NRLM is there. Also, we have transfer payment mechanisms. We programmed the whole idea in different ways and try to reach to the people. That's what we see here. So what is happening is we are also expanding the stakeholders, you know. So it has to be communicated to all stakeholders from top to down. There I see the importance of media. I think we have three panelists here from different areas. They will definitely reflect on how the idea of poverty and the implementation strategies, policies, how effectively we are taking to different stakeholders across the rural landscape in India from their own experience. I think this is the only point I want to say here. I request the first panelist given here, Sri Rizwan Ahmed, to start this discussion. Please take 5 minutes each, and then let us quickly come to a conclusion on this one. I think that's a way we can conclude it. We don't have the luxury of time here, you know. So it's over to Rizwan.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me here today for this wonderful discussion. I would begin with a Nida Fazli Sher. Nida Fazli is a very popular Urdu poet. He says, Rahegi vaadon mein qaid kab tak khushhali, har ek baar hi kal kyun, kabhi to aaj bhi ho. You know, that's where, you know, the crux of poverty lies in India. We know media is a sort of, you know, media has impeccable power of, you know, reaching to a large and diversified audience. It informs at various levels. It transforms our lives. But before I dwell upon this, you know, important topic, where we are today, you know, media vis-a-vis rural landscape of India, I would just begin my talk, you know, with a very small sort of, you know, TV story, which I sort of, I think 4 or 5 years back, this happened in 2019 parliament elections. It was like, you know, it was aired on Andy TV 24/7 on 7th of May. Head of Andy TV 24/7, Dr. Pranay Roy, he travels to Uttar Pradesh in a small village, you know, around 35-40 kilometers away from Lucknow. And he was sort of basically traveling to the SCST belt of, you know, Lucknow area, basically. And he was trying to interview a lot of people, you know, what are their problems, what rural India is basically, you know, how rural India look at this election. Is it like another new election for rural India, or that India has changed in this part of the world? So what are their, you know, ambitions? How do they look at this election? How do they look at the politics? How do they look at, you know, the policy makers? So he find out, you know, a sort of young couple recently migrated to, not migrated, you know, a young girl come to this particular village, married, newly married, and he started interviewing this young lady. Young lady was somehow feeling, you know, shy. Then suddenly there was a small girl beside this young lady. Her name was Sunaina. So this young girl of around 12, 13 years old, you know, she started prompting, giving answer behalf of this, you know, newly married lady. Then suddenly Pranay Roy, you know, he asked his cameraman to turn camera to this young girl of 12, 13 year old. And just look at the point of view of the rural India, you know, how it comes before you. Without any manipulation, I'm sure, you know, cameraman has not manipulated this story because it was sort of going impromptu. So this Sunaina had, you know, similar ambitions like any other girl, city girl, you know, maybe a sort of a small girl from Hyderabad, Delhi, or maybe Bangalore, Chennai. When she started telling about the problems of, you know, rural India, those were sort of eye-opening statements from the Sunaina. Pranay Roy asked, you know, interview this girl for half an hour without any cut. And the story was aired as such on the media in prime time slot. And you know what happens on our news channels, you know, we keep on commenting on social media. It's like dogfight, cockfight, you can name it anything actually. But there was no manipulation in this story. And this kind of story, the kind of story Pranay Roy was sort of broadcasting those ways, and the kind of impact this story has, you know, on the urban population as well as, you know, the larger audience, you know, those are the stories to tell actually. This young girl, Sunaina, she has ambition to become the doctor. She had ambition to become sort of starting her own clinic actually, but she doesn't have money even to go to school actually, leave the fee aspect of the school. She doesn't have, you know, food to eat for 3-time meal. She was wearing simple chappal, broken chappals, you know, going to maybe 3-4 kilometers to her barren lands. Pranay Roy travels, you mean, in this heat, scorching heat to her sort of fields there. And she is picking up, you know, this big sacks on her head and coming back to her house, actually. And she takes deep into the house, this camera, and I look at our kitchen. Nothing is there in the kitchen. Pranay Roy said, there is a cylinder there. Well, this cylinder is not sort of filled. This is, you know, there is no gas for so many months. So these stories tell, you know, the real scenario of India. But how many of such stories we see in Indian media actually? So when this story was aired on Andy TV, this was aired on 7th of May. Within 2-3 months, you know, there was a hashtag, Twitter hashtag Dr. Sunaina. More than 31 lakh rupees were collected in 3 months for Dr. Sunaina actually. So that was the impact of the, you know, if media really takes interest and tells the real stories of the, you know, rural world. She, Sunaina, was admitted in a very nice school in Lucknow. And then this money keeps on growing actually. Later, a trust came forward and they started collecting money. Not only Sunaina, her brother also was taking to a boarding school. So I was browsing the images of Sunaina, you know, sitting in a hostel room, beautiful bed, very nice chair and table studying. So her dreams were sort of you know, coming true before her eyes. Whole village, her parents appreciated this move of NDTV. So that is the power of media, actually, which we are missing in this part of world. I was sort of looking at a survey which was done, you know, 4 or 5 years back. There was a survey of, you know, 3 major English newspapers and 3 major Hindi newspapers, you know. When that survey revealed, you know, very, very sort of, you know, alarming situation in India, actually. So if you look at the major Hindi and English newspaper, you know, less than 2% of the coverage is given to the rural stories, which is very alarming, actually. Same is the case with the television also. So this is the business model we have created in India, actually. We don't have full-fledged, you know, science technology correspondent. We don't have agriculture correspondent, you know. We don't have health correspondent in press or in news, in television media. So where are we taking this media to, you know? Is it to serve the people of, you know, country? Or is it to serve only few people? This corporate model is not going to work, actually. So this situation is very well. Another example I would like to give, you know, when I was a student in college days, we used to listen to this All India Radio, actually. So All India Radio, on every Sunday, they used to sort of bring Prayojit Karyakrams. So those were sort of, you know, paid Karyakrams where, you know, films, newly released films used to be promoted. So those days, there was a film, I believe the name of the film was Tejaswani. See, the protagonist of this film was a female police officer. So the tagline of this, you know, 15-minute radio program was such, this is anchor used to say, this is the film, you know, after watching this film, these many girls from villages have joined police forces. So that is the impact of the cinema also. Many times, you know, we confuse digital media with just news media only, with only press. But media is an umbrella term, basically. So media covers each and everything, right from, you know, your newspaper, magazines, television, radio, cinema, folk media, now social media also. But are we giving sort of, you know, are we returning back, you know, in the same manner, whatever we are earning, what this corporate world of the media is earning from the society? Answer is big no. There is hardly anything is being, you know, 66%, Madam Akanksha was telling, 65-66% of the Indian population lives in villages, basically. And 75% of the poor, they live in villages. There are so many stories to be told. Why these stories are not coming forward? Look at the cinema scenario also. You know, if you, I would specifically talk about the Hindi cinema. You know, last 20 years, if you make an analysis of the Hindi cinema, just see the rural landscape in Hindi cinema. It's almost negligible. There was a parallel cinema movement which was deeply rooted in basically rural India those days. But that particular, those mise-en-scene is now, we are missing totally. Once in a while, if a film like People Live, maybe Swadeshi cannot be termed as a, you know, purely sort of dealing with the rural India issue. But yeah, somehow it touched a core of the rural India. But many films like, you know, Dangal or maybe Dabang, they are sort of, you know, created to sort of appease, you know, urban eyeballs, basically. It's like urban centric. We should not say this is a rural centric cinema. This is urban centric cinema. So what can be done? Can we generate a corporation? Can corporate come forward and generate a sort of, you know, 2,000-3,000 crore fund where we have independent media? That looks like a dream in this country, actually. Very, very difficult. Can we have a social corporate responsibility for the cinema as well? We do have a corporate social responsibility in India. But can, you know, every big producer take a pledge, maybe after 2 years, after 3 years, they will have a socially relevant films dealing especially with the rural issues? That also looks like a dream. We can suggest on this platform. So what can be scenario, what can be the, you know, changing scenario in India? Social media is another aspect which was part of the presentation, actually. So this is last two industrial revolution, you know, third and fourth revolution. This has done wonder to the, you know, this world, actually. What we call the digital world. So this digital world is basically the byproduct of the last two industrial revolutions. And this has really done, you know, wonders. This has democratized, you know, this world of media, basically. Social media, internet. If you look at the internet scenario in India, more than 650 million people, they are using internet in India. More than, you know, 450 million people, they have access to social media in India. And the, you know, the figures from rural India is very, very encouraging. Rural India is going to sort of surpass the urban India in terms of internet and social media usage. Within 3 years, you know, by 2025, you will be having, you know, more number of internet users and more number of the social media users in rural India. So can we explore this scenario? Can we sort of, you know, enable all the villages in India? Can we have public media in all villages of India? Which is now possible, actually. I'll take 2 more minutes. So it's not, it's very difficult to sort of sum up in 5 minutes, actually. So I'm looking for a scenario, you know, where you, let us not expect, you know, much from this, you know, corporate world. Let us sort of empower each and every village. Let's have public media there. Let us take the dream of Prime Minister of India, the digital India forward. Let us give it another dimension to this dream, beautiful dream of Honorable Prime Minister. It's possible, you know, we are giving crores of rupees to the, you know, village panchayat for 5 years. Why can't we allocate 10-15 lakh rupees for the communication system in a village? It's possible. Having a small projector, having a small screen, having sort of multimedia system, having a laptop, pick up, you know, 2-3 smart young boys from the villages, make them communication officer. Give them the responsibility to communicate, you know, rural stories. Connect this you know, communication panchayat to the, you know, best of the resources in the area. For example, universities in areas, you know, expert in this particular area, they can sort of speak on number of issues dealing with the agriculture, health, environment, anything, you know, you name it. There can be a 6-point chart also. So if you have sort of, you know, lot can be done. In fact, the, you know, different government schemes from different government bodies can be communicated directly to the villagers, actually. No need of, you know, this corporate world to sort of, because, you know, the manipulation of images in media is very, very dangerous. The poverty is projected as if, you know, this is the sort of, you know, this is God-given. This is the part of system. This is part of life. This is not like that, actually. Poverty is basically a crime. Poverty is not God-given. It is man-made, basically. So we have to confront this, you know, we have to confront this narrative, which has been sort of promoted over the years. So we have to create alternate media. We have to sort of bring in a ICT system which is viable, which can be created in each and every village, and we will sort of employ, you know, few young people in the villages by giving these alternatives. So I don't have much time. I wanted to speak more, maybe on some other time. We will sort of, you know, dwell on this subject. Thank you very much for giving this an opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Sri Rizwan. I request Ms. Seema Kumar to reflect on this.
A very good evening to everyone. Thank you, Rizwanji, for starting with a very powerful story. I think you have summed up the panel discussion today. Let me remove the mask. Maybe I will be clearer now. So I was saying that you have actually summed up with that powerful and experiential story of Sunaina, the panel discussion itself. And that is also the power of storytelling and the power of a very, very experiential story. So, and what media can do. So you brought the issue of poverty and the story and media together very, very beautifully. And that got me thinking to shift gears a bit, because yes, as you were also saying, and we recognize that we have limited time, at the same time, the issue that we are expected to speak on, the poverty and role of media, is very, very huge. So I would like to shift gears and narrow it down to some drivers which can make poverty more pronounced. And I was sitting there, I was thinking, I'm a woman, and how will poverty make my life more difficult because I'm a woman? How will poverty impact me if I'm a Dalit woman? How will poverty impact me if I live in a geography where services are not accessible, where social protection schemes are not reaching? How will it impact me then because of the geography where I live in? And there are, or if I live in an urban slum for that matter, how will it impact me? And I wanted to, with these examples where I was thinking myself in those roles, in those scenarios, I thought I would appeal to all the media professionals, filmmakers sitting here, and all other development professionals to to apply these lenses. I think if we pay attention to some of these lenses in our works, and I'm sure it is already happening, but as UNICEF, we work on these issues and we work all the time with media. Media is one of our very, very core and critical partner. We recognize the power of media and importance of media, especially during the pandemic times, when we were not able to reach out to people and be with them face to face, engage with them in through interpersonal methods. And that's when we recognized that we needed to depend on media a lot more, digital spaces, social media, and also mass media. But then again, mass media, we also recognize that the budgets, the funds allocation for mass media, whether it was content creation or content dissemination, was very, very limited. Thanks to the reach and penetration of social media now, the digital media, the internet, we were able to reach out to a large number of people, and we heard from other speakers and also the DG sir during the earlier session. On large number of people, all of us, I think, sitting here in this room have reached out to either through various training programs or through various communication interventions because of the reach of mass media, reach of internet media. And that brings me to the point that the way now people are consuming, the way now content is being created and the content is being disseminated, being consumed, is very, very different. Earlier, we had traditional mass media, but now I think as filmmakers, as media professionals, and also as development professionals, we probably need to think about what other avenues of media, and Rizwanji was speaking about some of those, what other channels we can count on in addition to the typical mass media and films and television channels, but what other sources of media we can deploy for communication efforts, not only on poverty, but all other drivers which impact poverty. If we have to reduce poverty, we do have to invest in health. And I will just give a simple example that if I have to, because of health conditions, if I have to spend on health, it makes the poverty more pronounced. If I use simple hand washing interventions and prevent our family members from being affected by diarrhea, then probably I can improve the attendance of children in school. I can also improve, save spending on health expenditure, save money from health expenditure. So the indirect impact of various other drivers, various other factors on poverty also need to be looked into. And as UNICEF, we would like to propose that through this panel discussion. I also would like to make a few suggestions, and I hope there will be other opportunities to take this discussion forward with some of the members present here, is investing into capacity building. And I think we heard about it in the earlier from the earlier speakers also. And in this room, there are various professionals belonging to media centers, whether these are within the academic institutions or training institutions such as NIRD. And how can we come together and invest into more rights-based, more human rights-based, maybe gender-responsive kind of communication content and also dissemination strategy? Can we bring together YouTubers? There are so many YouTubers now. Can we bring them together in a room like this and work with them, invest into, you know, plug, if there are any gaps, invest into some of those areas so that the content they are creating is, of course, has internet entertainment value, but also we are able to integrate some of these issues which can help us address poverty and other related issues. So some of these suggestions I would like to bring to the panelists, and especially to NIRD PR. I would like to, I can sense that time is getting up, so I would like to just close here by congratulating the organizers of the program. I also believe that today is NIRD's foundation day as well. So I do want to congratulate all the team members of NIRD and everybody who has been associated with this great institution. It's a very, very powerful institution for us to reach out to rural audiences. And I think it's really a privilege for us as UNICEF to have this collaboration. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for Ms. Seema. In fact, time is a major constraint. It's a big topic. I think it can be discussed even a full day, you know, as you said. I request Ms. Shruti Patil to give her reflection on this topic.
A very good evening to the dignitaries on dais and my friends in the audience. The previous speakers have so eloquently brought out the power of media, so I need not elaborate on that more. But I would just like to quote the Nobel laureate Amartya Sen. In one of his talks, he said, and I quote, "No democracy with a free press has ever had major famines." He goes on to illustrate his point by saying, despite China's greater success than India's in many economic fields, China had the largest famine recorded in history between 1958 and 61, with a mortality rate estimated close to 30 million. Although this famine in China raged for 3 years, the government was not pressed to change its disastrous policies. There was in China no parliament open for critical dissent, no opposition parties, and no free press. So you can understand the power of free media and the impact that it has. And I'm sure we can enumerate many such cases. The one coming to my mind immediately is that of the Nirbhaya case, where the sustained media campaign ensured change in the laws thereafter. So that is the power of media, my friends. And now coming to the role that it plays, apart from the dissemination, let me dwell more on the dissemination, because being an Indian Information Service officer, I have been in this job of communicating the policies and initiatives of Government of India to the target audience, be it, like, you know, the government brings out various welfare schemes. You saw in the movies screened earlier all these welfare schemes. But how does one person in a rural household knows what is he entitled for? That is where media is my biggest ally to convey this information. So, because unless the stakeholder is aware, the development program will not be successful. So dissemination is one part of it. Second part is the vigilance. The media, especially, I have seen during my posting in this state for many years now, the Telugu media, through its major district editions, has performed this role beautifully. They report the pilferage, they report the corruption in the implementation of the schemes, and which kinds of gives a course correction to the policy implementers. Apart from this, the first I saw, told the dissemination, then the vigilance, then comes, it can also, like, you know, influence how your policy is being implemented. For example, the recent farm laws, everybody had views, it was expressed in various media, and you saw the course of how the legislation took to the repeal a few days ago by the Honorable Prime Minister. So it gives a space, a platform for the experts, the stakeholders, the affected to vent out their perspective. Lastly, it also provides a platform for inputs for the policy making itself. For example, this government, I mean, most of you young people out there must have heard about the government website MyGov. MyGov is a website which crowdsources ideas. And you must have heard about the schemes like Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, or Swachh Bharat Mission. Why did these schemes gain so much of visibility? That was because of the public participation. Ideas came through these portals and the government took it seriously. So that kind of platform also the media provides. So apart from these three, four roles and the power, let me just enumerate two, three challenges what the media is now facing, for which was highlighted earlier also. The person who is affected or adversely affected by the systemic failure, a poverty-stricken household, will not go to the media directly and say, "Arey bhai, mujhe ye hua hai, ab dikhao." So the reporter should search for a story rather than the affected going to the media. For example, if an accident happens on a main road, the media is there. Nobody calls the media. But when systemic failures like these are there, it needs special, focused, narrow attention to bring out that problem to the national front or to a larger front. So that is one thing. And even if there is a very discerning reporter who does all this, Pranarai could do that. But not many people could, put it on the front page of the headline next day. That is the opportunity for the space, unless it is sensationalized, it is not considered TRP worthy. So that kind of space which is gets, it's a challenge. And then as we were discussing earlier, the political alignment of the media nowadays mostly puts out one point of view. So an intelligent consumer has to go through 3-4 points of view to form a neutral view. So that is one more challenge. But then leave aside the challenges, coming to the possibilities, they are enormous. Enormous in the sense, nowadays with the merging of the media, okay, we had the permanence of the print media, then came the sights and sounds of electronic media, but now it is the age of social media. Social media not only combines these two, like you can read the Hindu on social media, you can watch NDTV on social media, but also social media gives you a power to engage with the people, both for the political establishment to engage with the people, for the authorities to engage with the people, and for the people to engage vice versa with the authorities or with the politicians. For example, you have seen many tweets made by ordinary citizens, like every day in the paper it is that KTR responded to so and so needy person, some help was given. So the delivery of aid also happens because these issues are highlighted on the social media. So social media brings with it enormous possibilities. And as Rizwanji was telling about some statistics about how rural India will soon overtake urban India, a survey says that in 2 years from now, the users of internet in rural India would surpass that of urban India. Right now we have around 53 crore WhatsApp users. So what we in the communication job at the Government of India have done is use this power of social media to get across messages. Especially during the COVID time, we had to reorient our way of working. What we did was, since I had the regional outreach bureau also, we got this song and drama division artist to make small videos in the local Telangana dialect regarding COVID appropriate behavior, and then disseminated it through various WhatsApp groups, like the state government groups, to our ASHA workers groups, and moreover, what we did was we put them onto a mobile van which had an LED screen and sent that van to lot of interior districts and screened that wherever, now we need not, in the COVID times we didn't have gathering of people, 10 people, 15 people, but show it. And that was easily absorbed. So these are the means of communication even the government is adopting nowadays, change in its way of communication in order to reach out to the relevant target. But our counterparts in Mumbai got hold of a doctor from a tribal community who used to speak Korku language, made a small video and sent that video to Melghat Forest tribals, where there was huge vaccine hesitancy. And believe me, within 3 or 4 weeks, that vaccine hesitancy turned to 100% vaccination. So that is the power where, the media and communication can do wonders. So before, overstepping my time, I would like to say that with the age of merging of medias, it is up to us as to how we harness the power of media and use it to reach out to our target audience effectively and purposefully. I think we can all, stakeholders here in this hall and beyond, can work out collaborations to see that this target is achieved. Thank you.
Thank you for all the panelists. In fact, it was a very powerful, though it was very short time, because I could see that he started from the Sunaina story. And such a beautiful story. I remember that those days I also watched the same story. And then we moved towards the drivers. Certain things that driving the poverty and it's affecting the poverty. So it's taken to the drivers. And finally come to a very long list of challenges. That is the main purpose of the whole panel discussion. So made it here. In that way, it was a very successful panel discussion. I think I should take one or two. You should also participate in this panel discussion. So I should like to get 2 or 3 questions, to the panelists. Then we will conclude this one. So, let us ensure the participation also here. So any students from the backside, you know, there are many students sitting here. Yes, please.
Hello. Being an independent filmmaker, what we are facing when we are documenting any rural development issues in a corporate sector as well as there's some fund is a main issues. Okay, so though these films are very limited budget films, but we are always facing these things. And as you saw, lots of films over here. So we can also bring certain issues over there. But there is a challenge that we are not getting the right fund or right opportunity or right platform to showcase our work. So this is the one thing I think I want to add in this panel discussion.
I think it's not a question. You're just adding a value to the whole discussion. Okay, thank you. Any other observation or question? I think there's no questions. So I conclude this panel discussion here. So it's taken from Sunaina's stories to various challenges and all those things. So that's a takeaway. There are many takeaways here. I don't need to explain it. Everything once again. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Jyotish Satyapalan and the panel members. Now I request DDG sir to please present the bouquet to our panel members. Mementos. We'll start with Shri Rizwan Ahmed. Now I request Jyoti sir to present the memento to Ms. Seema Kumar. I request Professor Jyoti Satyapalan to present the memento to Ms. Shruti Patil.